So today I want to speak about the topic that attracted quite a bit of interest at the time when we covered it, and that's about IBM and their position on Richard Stallman and the FSF. We wrote about it sometime in summer, and it's actually about something we started last year. The main thing is, many people recall in 2019 when Richard Stallman sort of resigned from the Free Software Foundation. IBM made a statement, or Red Hat made a statement, but by that stage it was actually Red Hat under the control of IBM. And this is the statement that they made, and I highlighted it here. So it says here that Red Hat is urging the FSF board to seize the opportunity during its current leadership succession by appointing a president and members of its board that are more diverse, including from a national, racial, and gender perspective. So these are three things. So there's national, racial, and gender. Yeah. So this was just shortly after Richard Stallman had resigned. Now, the reason he resigned, and maybe it's worth doing a separate video about that. The reason he resigned, the way I see it, is because at the time, MIT was under intense pressure to do something about these scandals. Mostly, its association with Jeffrey Epstein and Epstein was a good friend of Bill Gates, and not only that, but we know from internal email from the tops of the chief of the of the AI lab and the media lab that Bill Gates was paying MIT, and he used Epstein, Jeffrey Epstein, as his kind of mole or his mule to bring in the money, and that's a big scandal. And almost nobody talked about it as soon as the attention was shifted to Richard Stallman, who was actually working in MIT and had nothing to do with any of the scandals. He just expressed an opinion about a dead friend of his. Right. So I'm going I didn't script this video. I'm actually experimenting with a new piece of software. As you can see, I can switch here between at least three displays, and it's going to be a lot more convenient to do videos like that. What I showed at the time is that when the when the IBM executives or Red Hat as the kind of leading company in contributions to GNU/Linux was talking about Stallman's and its appointment, it was just overlooking the situation, the possibility of actually being hypocritical about the whole thing, because you see, IBM isn't really diverse itself, as I showed here at the time. Almost all of the leadership in IBM is male, obviously mostly kind of Caucasian, as you know, as you might expect. I'm not saying these people are not qualified, but you know, and I'm not saying that they're chosen there just because they're male and you know, as they call it, white, you know. But the fact is, to go and speak to the you know, to the Free Software Foundation, this is what it looked like before the changes. So this is the Internet Archive. It showed Richard Stallman at the top, various members of staff. This is a copy from 2012. So this is Richard Stallman, an older photo, John Sullivan, various other people who are no longer in the FSF. Some of them are still in the FSF. I'm just going to go through down through the list, and that's Joshua Gay, who's now even talking of, you know, open source instead of free software. So who the hell knows what happens with him? He seems to—he was actually one of the people who signed the letters against Stallman. So I don't know what stands on these issues. There's a whole bunch of people here, and this is the board of directors, which at the time included Bradley Kuhn, who played a role in the ousting of Stallman from the FSF. And there's a few other people here, quite a few of them from academia in this case. That's 2012. Now jump to the present, and I will try to go as close as I can to the present. from you know, from the Internet Archive, you will find that currently the people employed there, look at this, one pop-up and then another pop-up. So FSF likes pop-ups now, I suppose. That's the new president. Used to be the treasurer, so he would know where the money comes from for the FSF, which includes IBM, or it used to include IBM, lots of Google money and stuff like that. These are the current people, so it's like male, okay, you know, sort of male. And then there's some females, and you know, can see here at least three females, because Zoe's there now as well. And the board, which includes includes two ladies, so it's like, you know, Kat and another new joiner. I'm not sure how to pronounce the name. So 40% of the board currently is female, and from different background, nationalities, and so on. Alexandre is actually, you know, I think he's a Brazilian, that's as far as I know he is. So there's quite a diversity here, and there was even before Stallman was kind of pushed out. Now, compared to IBM, or even Red Hat, as I pointed out, it took many years, I think until 2008, before Red Hat even had a second lady in its board of directors. In 2008, yeah, so they cannot really speak about diversity. This is IBM, look at that. I mean, never mind male or non-male and stuff, but, you know, okay, so Arvind was born to kind of a military family in India. And you can talk about the racial sort of aspects of things, but this is not a diverse board. And why, you know, I mean, look at them, when even one by one, even the, you know, at the top positions, this is not a kind of company that can preach the FSF about diversity. And but that's just exactly what they did, and they're trying to lecture the FSF that, you know, it's kind of good that Stallman was removed. You know, for the sake of diversity. Look at the Linux Foundation. I'm going to open the Linux Foundation page just very quickly here. So I'm just going to put it up on the screen before me, and I should mention I didn't script this video. I just kind of opened the pages I want to deal with. So I just kind of prepared the material before me, and you know, then I'm still experimenting with a new piece of software that lets me switch between cameras, not high quality cameras. Nonetheless, I'm just trying to do my best here to explain something. But let's look at the Linux Foundation. Just absolutely appalling. I think his name is pronounced Veeam. I think he's Belgian. And the guy here, he used to work for Microsoft briefly, but he mostly worked for Oracle. He was persuaded to go work for Microsoft. And he's the, as far as I know, this guy is still the vice chair of the Linux Foundation. Now, also, I think that the actual chair of the board is Erica. And it says here, COO at GitHub. Well, we know GitHub is Microsoft. She's basically a Microsoft employee and a Microsoft executive. So the board is controlled by a person who is the head of a unit, you can call it, of Microsoft, and the guy used to work for Microsoft. That's already not a good sign. But to make matters worse, going down here, this is the person for Microsoft who also is in the board of the Linux Foundation. There's quite a few people there in various places in the Linux Foundation, especially since they're funding the Linux Foundation. And I'm not going to talk about diversity aspect, but it's quite interesting that Microsoft likes to put quite a few ladies in the Linux Foundation, so it's easy to portray criticism of them as some kind of a chauvinism or a closeted sexism or something like that. But she's the one who's actually recently pushed in the register with Microsoft team, as they call him, Tim Anderson. They're pushing for Linux to kind of be moving towards GitHub, because according to her, it's very difficult to work with email to manage Git repositories. And now we say, well, people who can write code at a kernel level, you know, should be capable of handling things like email and patches by email. So it's kind of a straw man. Look at this, the Linux Foundation, they have spyware all over the site. I actually looked inside of it, and maybe that's a subject for a different day. They have lots of cookies and trackers and things like that. They don't care about your privacy. I mean, I always knew that. But I think it will be somewhere around here. I didn't prepare this video, I didn't script, I'm just doing it in one take, but I kind of know what I'm looking for. If you look at fellows, and you look at the people responsible for some of the technical things, you know, you have Torvalds here, you have a whole bunch of other people. If you look at the... it's the Technical Advisory Board, I believe, where... you have that's Chris Mason. He's actually a reasonably good guy. Chris Mason, I think he now works in Facebook. I think he used to work in Oracle. He works in file systems. But if you scroll down a bit, you'll find the guy who's responsible for maintaining the long-term kernel, along with you can always call him Microsoft Greg, because he used to work at Novell on Microsoft's payroll in part. He works for Microsoft, and he's on the technical advisory board of Linux Foundation. He's also one of the people who deal with the long-term support of the kernel. So he works for Microsoft. So that's another guy right there who works there. And there's a bunch of GPL violators here also, and some of the people who are pushing to change the languages and remove supposedly offensive language from the kernel. Now, if you look at the leadership, and I've covered this before, so even though I didn't prepare this video, I can just, you know, tell you up front that there will be one person here, and at least one person, yeah, Robin Jean, I think it's pronounced Jean. So both in the OSI, which is infiltrated by Microsoft, and most of the budget goes towards Microsoft through GitHub. It's ridiculous. The OSI is a subject for a different video, I suppose, but she works in this thing called OpenJS, which she leads. She, as far as I know, she came from a marketing agency from Edelman. Quite a few Microsoft people came from there, and so quite a few people from Edelman ended up in the Linux Foundation, because it's kind of a marketing front more than a technical thing. But This person is in leadership in the Linux Foundation, and she works for Microsoft as well. Let me see if I can, yes, I can open that. So, let me see. So, okay, she spent more than 10 years at Microsoft. So, you know, it's the company's shift to openness. She co-founded Open at Microsoft, which is basically an open washing of Microsoft. So she used to be in Edelman. If I can push this up a bit. No, she used to work in a marketing agency, and there were other people in the top of the Linux Foundation in CXO type of roles who work in Edelman. This is a marketing agency. And this is one of the bosses of Linus Torvalds. So he needs to be careful criticizing Microsoft, because quite a few of his bosses are from Microsoft, being salaried by Microsoft at present. So, you know, he doesn't really have much freedom of speech. And in terms of diversity, and one of the things that I wrote about before, let me just try to find it, if we look for African American. So the Linux Foundation, when there was this whole bunch of riots about African Americans being discriminated and being attacked by police officers, the Linux Foundation came up with a ridiculous statement about diversity, because if you look at the Linux Foundation board, you will never find any black person there. And as I pointed out at the time, that's in the headlines, they're based in the US, and in the US, I looked it up just to be sure, it's 13.4% of the population can sort of declare itself to be, you know, African American. You know, some people they're mixed, so it depends on how they classify themselves, but why can the Linux Foundation not have one a single black person, while at the same time writing loads of tweets and bragging about how much it supports black people? You know, and it's kind of an issue, and the Linux Foundation also uses the whole diversity stick or spiel to kind of say that to kind of say that, you know, we are the good people because we support diversity. But if you actually look at these things, and one of our readers and contributors, she is a person of a minority group, and she's long been involved in Linux since the 90s, and she's a developer and stuff. She looked into this stuff, and she inquired, and she actually found, and eventually after inquiries, she found that even though the Linux Foundation makes a huge amount of money, and at the time it was already approaching 100 million, now it's more than 100 million a year, they don't actually give to any of those minority groups much money at all, and some of those don't want even to comment on what they're being given by the Linux Foundation. So the Linux Foundation just uses this thing, this kind of the cause of feminism and blacks, you know, blacks in technology, but there's no evidence they actually support them in any way. They just say they support them. Maybe they put the name of the groups on the page, but they don't actually support them in any substantial way. So there is, you know, I don't want to kind of put myself in a position where I can be scrutinized too much, but there is this kind of evidence to show that they're using the diversity cause, or the kind of the growing awareness that there is unfairness, and there is unfairness, there's discrimination in pay, there's discrimination in hiring, and so on. But they're using that to distract us, I think, from some of the corporate elements at play. So if you mention things like, you know, there's too much of Microsoft in a certain establishment, which is being also attacked by Microsoft, they will say that they actually are doing it for the better because they're kind of encouraging diversity, and they introduce women and black people to technology, which on the surface, yeah, it's true that it's a good thing to do so, but it discourages you from actually expressing concerns about the real issues at hand. And in the case of the FSF, they, as soon as Stolen was removed, they portrayed it as kind of a positive thing, because here's a chance to, you know, enhance the gender diversity and nationalities and stuff in the FSF. And I don't really think that that's genuinely what they wanted. I think they just didn't like the opinions of Richard Stallman.